PW Farrell's Bass Lessons. Thanks for listening to that, Desan. That was me playing along with Niels-Henning Ørsted Pedersen's bass solo he does over Au Privave. And I lifted it from the Oscar Peterson Trio album called Nigerian Marketplace. Niels-Henning Ørsted Pedersen was an amazing, I think, Danish bass player. I saw him play a few times, and he was one of my favourite all-time double bass players just because I think because I saw him at the right age. I got to see him play live, which is unusual for a kid in Brisbane, Australia, to see one of his favourite jazz players playing. I loved how diverse he was. He did a lot of small group stuff, a lot of big group stuff. He sort of had session chops. He could lay it down for a big band. And he was a great soloist and technician. I just loved him. I think he died about 10 years ago now, maybe longer even. And so that was an old transcription that I did probably 15 years ago. I have a bunch of old transcriptions I've been going through and just working them up slowly by speed because I, at the time when I did them, I probably didn't really have the chops to be able to really play them comfortably. And now I'm really enjoying going back and trying to learn them to the point where I am imagining that I am the performer who first did it because it's getting to the point. I mean, I think the secret to understanding transcription is to get to the point where you no longer listen to the original instrument you transcribed, but you become that instrument, and then you can listen to the rhythm section around you as you play it, and it's like you're playing it for the first time. Obviously, what's better than being able to play with the world's best drummers, the world's best piano players, guitarists? So that's one of the most obvious benefits of transcribing. The other thing is you're working on so many things. You're working on your memory, your musical memory. You're working on intangibles, a musical IQ, things that dissecting music in the partition practice method I've spoken about, you can't really work on these things when you're doing that stuff. But in my opinion, look, I'm sure there are people who disagree with me, and I was at a Tigran Hamasyan workshop the other day where he said that he thinks that you can just do transcription. I think that for me at least, it was really beneficial to do the partition practice method because it gave me a handle on being able to manage all the stuff I need to practice. And I think that once you then can get around your instrument and really know it inside out, then the transcription really kicks in. So let's talk about it for a minute. That solo, it's a bebop in the bebop style, okay? So bebop is that style of jazz with all the voice leading that you hear in the melodies. Like if the most classic one, the most obvious bebop melody that most electric bass players know is Donna Lee because it's on the Jaco debut album. So that's the one that goes boom to go. That one. That one. And it goes on and on. That was like one of the ones that I learnt first because it's off the Jaco record, right? And every bass player knows that. And when I first started learning that and had really no understanding of this stuff, it just seemed like this random series of notes and I had no idea how I was going to memorise it. But what's really funny about bebop is it goes from being seemingly like this series of just random notes to being the most simple stuff. Because it's just chord tones being approached chromatically. That's pretty much every bebop melody. You know, Donna Lee is the seventh with some ornamentation. chromatic approach to the next seventh. Yeah. It's so much of it is like that seventh. The amount, if you go through these, like Donna Lee, the amount of thirds and sevenths at the start of every bar is just insane. So it's not the huge mystery anymore that it used to be. But what it is I think because these melodies are so, I don't want to say formulaic, but I'd say functional. It's making melodies, it's making melodic statements that happen to be really strong in voice leading. Because they're so steeped in that stuff, the first thing is they work at every tempo. Like if you take any bebop here, like even if we take his solo and we slow it down and we go, yeah. So if we take his solo and slow it down, it's gonna work, I guarantee you. It doesn't need to be burning. I'll start it again. So hard because it's using the same kind of voice leading and functional harmony. It's just fleshing it out and getting it up to eighth note speed. And so I think if you can have that in your playing, it's a really valuable tool because you're basically understanding harmony to the point where you can just burn through it spontaneously. In fact, I find bebop, just a bebop blues, or explaining to seasoned musicians who aren't jazz musicians, explaining to them how to solo in more of a bebop fashion over a blues really helps open their minds up to this idea of chords as key centers. You know, I mean, that's, I think I've spoken about that a few times in my lessons, but the big difference between, like, say, for example, a rock blues player is the rock and a jazz player, especially a bebop player, is that the rock blues player might go, Where's the blues thing? Oh, the bebop thing. Much more harmonic content as I'm moving along. That to me is one of the useful things about sort of explaining this stuff to people who are wanting to get more of an impression of what the jazz thing is, because it's taking it's going beyond just the idea of chord symbols representing chords to almost representing key centers. Well, representing key centers, literally, not almost, literally representing key centers. So one scale over the whole thing isn't going to cut it. Same sort of thing in Niels-Henning's solo, because he's using that bebop genre. If you click on the link and you look at this Niels-Henning transcription, you'll be able to follow this video a lot more easily. If I look at the first few bars of this, even just the first two bars of this solo, where he goes, so we've got these two double chromatic approaches. He's hitting the fifth, but with a double chromatic approach, and then hitting what is technically the fourth of the B flat 7 chord, but I reckon because of the speed this tune's going at, he's actually still thinking F7. He does it a few times actually. He sort of just plays through that B flat 7 with melodic ideas that are clearly coming more from the F blues kind of sound. So straight away, if I do this transcription and then I start jamming and I want to start using it in my solos, what I can do is I can take little snippets of ideas that Niels-Henning has done. So I can straight away try this double chromatic approach. So maybe, mm-hmm. Something like that. What's something else he does? He hits the 13th a lot. Let's muck around with that. So, you can just rip an aspect of his ideas and experiment with creating new music using those ideas. Another thing that he does in this solo is he actually at times ignores the B flat 7 chord that is in bar 2 of the jazz blues form. He plays lines that are just clearly F blues scale or sort of playing notes, like, for example, he sits on the 4th, the perfect, like, the 11th of the B flat 7, which normally that'd be quite a dense sound, you know. Now, it's not a bad sound, but, I mean, I love a flat 9, don't get me wrong. But if you hear it at tempo, I don't think he's thinking. I think he's just thinking the whole thing as, you know. And even though that example may be a little bit dubious, maybe, I mean, because it still does work if you think of it as a B flat 7, there's definitely sections there later on where he's just thinking F blues. And I don't like to talk about scales, but it is like he's thinking F blues scale through those first four bars, even though there's a big fat B flat 7 chord. At one point he goes, I mean, that's, yeah, that's, if that's not, if that's not the F blues scale, I don't know what is. So what's the point? The point is that despite wanting, like, often I will talk to people all about being, you know, being able to play the harmony and using functional harmony to guide your melodies and stuff, there's also poetry, and there's times that you, I mean, it's all about music, it's not about rules, and in this solo you can see where he switches gears from outlining in a classic bebop fashion to thinking more of like just blues scale and imbuing those vibes. The other thing that's interesting about this solo is, because it's so fast, he makes decisions that he probably wouldn't make if he was playing it a lot slower. And that's another example of, like, when I talk about that B flat 7 chord, when he does that, I mean, you know, if you're thinking that could be over this, you know, he probably wouldn't make that decision if he was going to sit there for a long time. Harmony is influenced by tempo and rhythm, and if you just get too stuck on learning transcriptions off the page and not learning what they really sound like and playing them, then you're not even getting half the story. You're getting like 10% of the story. Check it out. It's a great solo. He's a great player. And next lesson I'm just going to look at the walking part that's of this record. Anyway, hope that helps you out. Peace.